Danae, thank you so much for joining me today. Where are you calling in from?
I am calling in from Houston, Texas.
Because you were supposed to have been in Washington, D.C., right?
Yes, I was actually mid-run of Samson and Delilah at the Kennedy Center. And thankfully, I was able to perform three shows.
So I know that you clearly dominated the role, and I'm quite bitter because I was actually supposed to fly in to see you.
I know.
You're my bestie. I wanted to be there to support you. Let's focus on the positives. What was the best part of that production?
Oh my gosh, there were so many amazing aspects. Collaborating with the people on this particular opera was such a special experience. Everyone was just so excited about this new production. For my first Delilah, it was really like nothing could have gone better.
With Mother's Day just passing, we have to talk about your number one fan, Miss Pam Bridges. So at that performance, she kind of made a moment during your curtain call.
Bravo! Bravo!
Her show. I am because of her. So,
speaking of your mom, what are some of your favorite memories of Miss Pam Bridges?
Wow. So my mother, she really is the true diva. She's an educator. So she created this education wrap just to connect further with her students. My mother, being the creative being that she is, had all of us in the family, my three siblings and my father, go around to her classrooms and tour this rap.
I'm Mrs. Bridges, and I'm here to say that education is the only way you can party hardy, and that's all fine, but when you're getting down with it, don't forget your mind. I don't care if you come from near or far. You too can be an academic star. Just study hard and do it right and watch your grades go out of sight. Black, white, doesn't matter what the color, short, tall, sister or brother, stand up and be proud of yourself because you're just as smart as anybody else.
We were on tour. We were on tour at whatever school she was teaching at, and we still rap the education rap every once in a while. Now I look back and I'm just like, wow, my mother is one of a kind.
She also made, what was that CD called when you were at
MSU? Oh, when I was a student at the Manhattan School of Music, she had this brilliant idea of taking the songs that I would sing for my juries and these recitals and making a CD out of it.
She's a total force.
She is a total force, and I definitely owe like where I am today because of her. We called it the transformation, and it actually is kind of cool because you can hear the transformation in my sound and musical maturity from my freshman year to my senior year.
Something else that she used to do is she would make you meet up with other people and talk about your features and how special you were.
Yes, so I grew up in Tacoma, Washington, which is south of Seattle. I was one of a kind. I was usually the only African-American girl. I was surrounded by people that did not look like me. She noticed that, and so she said, okay, we are going to get some self-confidence in you because something's happening where you're kind of just losing who you are. There was this group called Sisters of Vision, and it was all African-American girls, and we would get together and, you know, talk about our features and what it is to be a Black woman in America and promoting self-love. So we would read Maya Angelou poems, Toni Morrison. Maybe the most dramatic thing that my mom ever did in like enforcing that self-love is take me and put me in front of a mirror and be like, this is your nose, this is your hair, you are beautiful and Black, instilling and ingraining the features that God has blessed me with. And so I'm just thankful, like she is the mother of all mothers. And I just hope and pray that I get an ounce of that if I, you know, become a mother one day.
That is like the sweetest thing for a mother to do with their daughter, because I know I've struggled with self-confidence over the years, and especially as artists, it's so hard.
Absolutely.
A mom like yours who basically was like, you are never going to not be confident and love yourself like that.
You do not have a choice in this matter. In terms of like someone trying to bring me down, thank you, Mom.
So as someone who is almost exclusively living out of a suitcase. You found a way to make every city you work in a home away from home.
I go salsa dancing in every country that I sing. And salsa is like this universal dance language. And so I've really had an amazing time finding different salsa clubs. Also, I just have like a whole list. Restaurants, parks, basketball courts. I make it a point to go to Michelin star restaurants, you know, and say, hello, I'm Dane Bridges. You know, build a relationship with these different restaurants, because why not? I think it's important to create relationships wherever you go.
You are an ambassador of opera everywhere that you go.
Absolutely.
You can't self-promote. Who's going to promote you? Nobody.
Who said it? And this is why you're my bestie.
One thing that we have always bonded over would be an obsession with fashion. So I've just got to know, besides me.
Of course.
Who are some of your favorite designers?
I love Ralph Lauren, Luliang. Kristen Siriano is like the man. And I've worn one of his pieces, this fierce pinstripe pantsuit, and the pinstripes were made out of hand-painted glitter. And I actually wore it when I sang at Jesse Norman's memorial at the Met this past fall, and it got a lot of good feedback.
I was obviously very inspired by you when designing this print that I'm wearing right now, the Janae. I would love to go through some of Janae's most iconic looks.
Gosh, okay, cool. I wore this bodycon dress when I sang at Carnegie Hall. It was this beautiful emerald green long sleeve bodycon dress.
The second you walked onto the stage, everybody was like,
this yellow kind of sparkly gown that I wore, Cardiff Singer of the World competition. I saw this gown in the window and I said, that's it. No, that I have to wear that.
You were like, Suzanne, I bought this gown. Like, you have to see it. It's amazing. Three.
So I was in Israel a couple years ago. They have this avenue, all couture gowns. And I went crazy. I ended up buying this incredible gown that had hand embroidered flowers. We did a beautiful photo shoot. This gown literally made me feel like I could do anything. And so I did.
I love that. It made me feel like I could do everything. So I did.
Exactly. That's what clothes should do. You know, you shouldn't feel like you're imprisoned in clothing. You should feel liberated.
As the number one opera mom, what makes you different from other parents of the stage?
Well, I am a former educator, so I just love learning new things. And this whole opera experience has been very new for me. So I get so pumped and so excited that I've just become a groupie. And wherever Janae goes, I want to go. And honestly, I've been very, very fortunate to be able to do that.
So now it is time for Opera Mom to take center stage. Would you bring back the family to perform your amazing education rap for
us? No way, are you serious? Okay, my whole family knows this. Janae, feel free to join in.
Do you remember the rap?
Most of it, yeah.
So I have to give you a little background. So I taught special needs students for a large part of my life. I just wanted them to learn everything I taught them in the best way they could. And I found everybody was rapping. My kids would come to the classroom and they'd be going. So I came to school one day and we did math facts and I started rapping the facts. Everything was rhythmic and they loved it. And so I was reading on an educational magazine and I came across this rap. It's really not mine. It's called the Education Rap. It was a poem. And I put the poem to rhythm and came to school the next day, and I opened my lesson by saying, okay, I've got something for you. You guys think you can rap? I'm gonna do my little old school rap. And oh my God, they loved it.
Drum roll.
So I'm Mrs. Bridges, and I'm here to say that
education is the only way
to party hardy, and that's all fine, right. But when you're getting down with it, don't forget your mind. I don't care if you come from near
or far. You too can be an academic star.
Just study hard and do it right. And watch the great show outside.
Oh my goodness, that was everything.
Bravi!
I just like to have fun with whatever I do to just make life interesting. And what makes me happiest is getting on a plane and going to see Janae Marie Bridges perform. I can't wait to get on a plane again.
I'm just thankful for my mama and papa.
A mother held her new baby and very slowly rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she held her, she sang, "I love you forever. I like you for always. As long as I'm living, my baby you'll be."
The baby grew. He grew and he grew and he grew. He grew until he was 2 years old, and he ran all around the house. He pulled all the books off the shelves, he pulled all the food out of the refrigerator, and he took his mother's watch and flushed it down the toilet.
Sometimes his mother would say, "This kid is driving me crazy!"
But at nighttime, when that two-year-old was quiet, she opened the door to her room, crawled across the floor, looked up over the side of her bed, and if she was really asleep, she picked her up and she rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she rocked her, she sang, "I love you forever. I like you for always. As long as I'm living, my baby you'll be."
The child grew. They grew and they grew and they grew. They grew until they were 9 years old.
And he never wanted to come in for dinner. He never wanted to take a bath. And when grandma visited, he always said bad words. Sometimes his mother wanted to sell him to the zoo.
But at nighttime, when he was asleep, the mother quietly opened the door to his room, crawled across the floor, and looked up over the side of the bed. If he was really asleep, she picked up that 9-year-old and rocked him back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while she rocked him, she sang,
"I love you forever. I like you for always. As long as I'm living, my baby you'll be."
The child grew. They grew and they grew and they grew. They grew into a teenager with strange friends, strange clothes, and strange music.
Sometimes the mother felt like she was in a zoo.
But at nighttime, when that teenager was asleep, the mother opened the door to their room, crawled across the floor, and looked up over the side of the bed.
If she was really asleep, she picked up that great big girl and rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
And when she rocked her, she'd sing,
"I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, my baby you'll be."
Well, that mother, she got older. One day, she called her child and said, "You'd better come and see me because I'm very old and sick." So her child came to see her, and when he came to the door, she tried to sing the song. She sang, "I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always." But she couldn't finish because she was too old and sick. Her child went to her, and he picked her up and he rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And then he sang her the song.
"I'll love you forever. I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living, my mommy you'll be."
When the son came home that night, he stood for a long time at the top of the stairs. Then he went into the room where his very new baby daughter was sleeping. He picked her up in his arms and very slowly rocked her back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And while he rocked her, he sang,
"I'll love you forever.
I'll like you for always. As long as I'm living,
my baby you'll be."